We have updated the presentation with the last updates in the standards and on the different projects we have been working in. Okay, well, this is the agenda of the webinar. Well, I'm Anton Roman, CTO at Quovis. I'll give the first part of the presentation, and then Vitor will continue with the second part, which will be focused on IMS and all the security and identity issues related to IMS, to WebRTC when in IMS environments. Okay, so in the first part, I will present very quickly different kinds of voice over IP attacks. Then I will present WebRTC vulnerabilities which are related to adding WebRTC to your existing systems. Then I will present the protection mechanisms that must be included, and then I will present identity management mechanisms which are being used in WebRTC. Okay, so let's start. So I'm pretty sure that all of you know what WebRTC is. Okay, WebRTC is a multimedia framework which allows to establish real-time multimedia connections from a browser to another endpoint, which can be a browser or any multimedia device. One of the best parts of WebRTC is that it works off the shelf. You don't need to install any plugin. Well, we'll see that for screen sharing at this, right now is necessary, but you don't need to. It's going to work, and it works in almost any platform without installing anything else than the browser. Well, the WebRTC is being standardized by two organizations. The W3C defines the API, the JavaScript API exposed by the browser, and the IETF defines all the part of WebRTC which goes on the wire, okay? All the protocols. Well, as I said, WebRTC is multi-device. Well, it's designed to work fine in desktop laptops, any kind of tablet and notebook, and smartphones, and also in web TVs, and well, in almost any device. Currently, we are working in, especially in the web TV, in some interesting projects to add real-time communications to web TVs. Well, what are the different use cases of WebRTC? Well, on one side, we have WebRTC uses in the corporate environment. It can be a replacement of existing unified communication tools to connect the different workers to the network of the company or to the network of the operator. It will also be a good replacement for tools like the GoToWebinar we are using right now. Okay. So, and also to enable click-to-call solutions so that the customers and other colleagues will be able to, well, actually can make a call from the browser to your cellular phone or to your browser without installing anything, just by clicking a button in a web page. Okay. Also for contact centers on the agent side, the agents will be able to receive calls in a web browser without needing any physical device. Okay, so the deployment of new contact centers is going to become much cheaper. We are working also in projects like this. Okay, and on the residential side, I think is where there is a very wide field for new applications. Well, we can think about OTT services and also for web chats and a lot of vertical applications related with e-health or e-government. And well, also for video gaming, you have to take into account that WebRTC is not only about video and audio, but it's also about sending real-time data, and that's a very nice feature for video games. And well, and in the future, new media will be added. Okay, so right now we think about video and audio, but in the next years, I'm sure we'll see more media types that will be included to WebRTC. Okay, well, this is an example of architecture of WebRTC. This is on the on the right. You can see an existing network of an operator, for example, an IMS core. And then to be able to offer WebRTC services, to so that the users can join your network from a web browser, you need to add at least two elements. You need to add a WebRTC gateway, which translate signaling and media from the website to the IMS side, to a telephony side. And you also need a server, an application server, for the WebRTC application itself, okay? And you need to do a lot of things there, like authentication, control the quality of service of the service you are delivering to your customers, and many other things. So the idea is that you are introducing new elements in the network, and you are also introducing new threats. So it's important to be aware of all the new entry points you are opening in your network, okay, and how we can protect them. Okay, so if you are interested in security issues in WebRTC, you can check this IETF draft. Well, all the relevant considerations taken into account when defining the RFCs related to WebRTC were considered. Okay, so this is a very nice source of information related to security in WebRTC. Well, we are going to review the most important voice over IP attacks. Okay. One of the characteristics of the attacks in voice over IP is that these attacks causes an immediate economic damage. For example, if someone gets the credentials of your email account, of course, it's a very important problem because you can have a lot of sensitive information there. But it's not so easy to make money with that. But if someone gets your the credentials of your voice over IP account, it's pretty easy to make money with that. Okay. So, well, we are going to define four types of attacks. Okay. The first one is denial of service. The goal of a denial of service attack is to try to exhaust the resources of the servers with which are providing the service. Basically, well, you try to run out the memory of the server, or of try to use a huge amount of bandwidth. Okay, in some cases the denial of service attack is accidental. For example, when you have a problem with the firmware of the new phones you are deploying in your network, and those phones send any kind of request which is erroneous and it's being sent in a is a lot of requests are being sent in a very short time. Okay, in our cases, those attacks can be intentional or maybe can be caused by a problem in the network, and when the network that problem gets recovered, you receive a lot of traffic in a very short time. Okay. Well, the most important attacks are fraud attacks because they are very profitable. I think this is a problem, a very important problem for many operators. And well, you can deploy a lot of mechanisms to prevent this from happening, and you can also introduce very advanced monitoring tools in your network to try to discover behaviors which can mean that you are suffering a fraud attack. Okay. Well, another problem is illegal interception. It means that someone gets the media you are sending to the other side. In WebRTC, this is not easy because WebRTC is encrypted by default with standard browsers. Without modifying the source code, it's not possible to send unencrypted media. Okay, so, and the encryption key used in WebRTC is being negotiated in the media flow. So illegal interception is not easy, but this is possible right now in many existing systems which are not being encrypted. It's really easy to get the media flows to, well, for example, if you are making a call from your laptop and you are using a Wi-Fi, it's not so difficult to sniff the traffic and hear everything you are telling to the other endpoint. Okay. Well, and the last one is the illegal control. For example, in the case of man-in-the-middle attacks, when you think that you are talking to one person and you are really talking to another person. Okay. And well, there is a lot of types of illegal control attacks. It's not easy to describe all of them in just 1 hour. But well, with WebRTC applications, those attacks are also possible, are even more easy to to make. Okay. Well, okay. Let's see now the WebRTC vulnerabilities. Okay, the vulnerabilities which are related to WebRTC. Well, the first and most important one is that WebRTC access to the camera and the mic of your laptop, and so potentially you can be sent from the browser media to any other endpoint. Okay, that's something that has been solved in WebRTC because you have to allow explicitly that you want to share the media. Well, but in some cases, an attacker can try to confuse the user so that they allow to exchange media, to record it and to use it for anything. Okay. Well, this could be an example of attack, but in this case, a WebRTC application is shared by a malicious server, and then they can use your voice or your image to do any other thing. Okay, so well, there are some things that that already happens right now with other kind of web applications, but in WebRTC this can be pretty critical. Okay, this is especially dangerous in the case of screen sharing because it's possible to get very sensitive information that you can be working on a different window, and if you allow a screen sharing, from another web page, you can be sending an attacker can see what you are doing in your laptop. Okay, so in the WebRTC standards, some mechanisms to prevent this from happening are being described. Okay, so it's not so easy. We'll see how the screen sharing will work from now on. Okay. Well, WebSocket is different from WebRTC. Okay, WebSocket is a protocol which allows to establish a full duplex connection between a browser and a server. Formerly, this was done with HTTP, but in a non-native way. Okay, but right now it's possible to do that with WebSocket. But WebSocket, if doesn't go over TLS, is clear text, so it's not difficult to see what you are sending on the web. Okay, so another threat that WebSocket brings is that it allows cross-origin. So, for example, if you want to set up a denial of service attack against a server, for example, the server of the competence, well, you can use another web page, okay, so that the users try to make a call to another server. Okay, so it's necessary to, and this you can multiply this by millions, so an attacked server can receive the connection requests from millions of browsers. Okay, so it's important to avoid this kind of attacks. Okay, so one of the most relevant issues when dealing with security is that in many applications TLS is not being used, so all the traffic goes in clear text, and that makes things really complicated to protect. So when you are working with WebRTC, it's necessary to use always TLS and always with valid certificates, especially if you are working with Firefox, because it's if you don't use HTTPS and valid certificates, you can get into trouble when trying to develop WebRTC applications, even for testing environments. Okay. I don't know if you know what TARN is. Okay, TARN is a protocol which relays the traffic. It's not only designed. It wasn't designed only for WebRTC. It was designed several years ago, and it allows to exchange real-time traffic when both endpoints are behind symmetric NATs, and also when they are behind firewalls and proxies. Okay, because you can send the traffic not only over UDP, you can also use TCP and TLS for that. Okay, but well, when you are relying media, you are offering an expensive resource to the users. Okay, you are offering bandwidth, so you have to protect that with credentials. And if one attacker can get credentials of your TAN server, they can use it for free. So it's important to protect them. Right now, I think there is a working document, there is a draft, to define a REST API to be able to access the TAN server, okay? To be able to establish a TAN session. So, well, this is, I think this is pretty important in production environments, because, the TARN servers are easy to attack if you don't protect the credentials. The idea is to use credentials which are only going to be valid for one use. Okay. So, and this is another thing you have to take into account when deploying WebRTC services. Okay, and also if you deploy a click-to-call solution, for example, you in the website of an online shop, you can put a button so that the customers can click on it and contact the and contact center or whatever. You can when you are exposing things in the internet, you are opening it to be used by anyone. So you have to control the amount of calls which are made and the IPs from which they are made. And many other things. Okay, so this is this can be a problem if you when you offer a click-to-call service. So now we are going to see protection mechanisms. The first and most important one is to use TLS always. Okay, with TLS we get privacy, integrity, and authentication. The authentication can be for the server side, okay? It's important to use always valid certificates with WebRTC, but it can the authentication can be bidirectional, and the client can also authenticate using certificates, and this can be very useful when deploying WebRTC applications where you have to certificate the identity of the of any of the callers. Okay, another relevant thing here is that screen sharing only works from HTTPS sites. Okay, so that's one of the reasons why it's so important to use HTTPS. The access to devices is always you always are asked for permissions when the browser wants to share your media. Okay, this is mandatory in all the browsers. Another common practice is to show the video which is being sent to the other side always. This is an example of unified communication application. Okay. When you are using HTTPS, the permissions to share the media are always stored in the browser, so you don't have to click on it always you make a call. So that's another good reason to use always TLS. And now let's see the permissions about the screen sharing. In this case, you have two kind of permissions, okay? You have something which is called elevated permissions. This is the name which is used in the W2G documents. In practice, this means to install and Chrome or Firefox extension. You only have to install it once, but it breaks a little bit the philosophy behind WebRTC. But why do you have to do that? Because by installing the extension, you are aware that you are going to be able to share your screen. Okay, and additionally to the extensions, you will always have to give permissions to share your screen, and you will see all the time a little warning like this, and you will be able to stop sharing your screen at any moment. Okay. This is more a curiosity than something very important, but I included it. In the case of WebSocket traffic, which is very used to create WebRTC applications, because as I said, it allows you to create a bidirectional connection between the browser and the server. When you are sending traffic from the browser to the servers, if you capture the traffic and you see it with old version of WiSAC, you will only see different characters, because the traffic is being masked. All the characters are being masked. The reason to do that is to avoid poison servers which can be between the browser and the server. Okay. For example, HTTP proxy which stores the most visited page. If you know how the traffic you are sending is going to look on the wire, it could be possible to do things like poison the cache of your HTTP proxy. And when another person is going to visit that page, the proxy serves a fake page. Okay, so that's the reason why the traffic is being masked in WebSocket from the browser to the server. In the server to browser side, the traffic is in clear text. Okay. Well, and also denial of service attacks. This is something common in the web world. Okay, this is not only for WebRTC. Well, but the same protections that are applied to other web environments need to be applied here. Okay, especially for WebRTC gateways, it's important to use always port 443 and 80 to avoid problems with firewalls and proxies. And those ports are normally the receive attacks from external tools. Okay. So, well, let's move to the media. WebRTC uses DTLS SRTP. In DTLS SRTP, the negotiation of the key, which is going to be used to encrypt the media to using SRTP, is negotiated directly on the media flow. So you don't need to exchange the key in the signaling, and even if the signaling is not encrypted, it's not going to be possible to decrypt the media, okay? And well, you will have a fingerprint in the SDP generated by the browser to establish a security relationship between the SDP and the actual media you are receiving, okay? So the main idea here is that media is secure by default in WebRTC. Well, also in ICE, which is the protocol used to establish to try to discover the best path between two WebRTC endpoints, it includes some mechanisms of security to avoid receiving traffic from any endpoint not involved in the media establishment. Well, this is by default, okay? You don't have to do anything here to use those mechanisms. Are described in the standard, and ICE is not only used for WebRTC, it's also used in other voice over IP in general. Okay? And the last one is monitoring, okay? Monitoring your system is very important. The same way you do with your voice over IP network, you have to monitor your WebRTC system. And in this case, you have even more information than in a normal voice over IP system, because you can get information from the IP, which is generating the request. You can also do that in voice over IP. But in this case, you can know the host URL which is generating the session. You can get info from the browser, and you can also get contextual information when the system is designed to do that. Okay, so you can gather a lot of information, which can be valuable to detect that you are suffering an attack. But it can also be very valuable for the marketing guys. Okay, so is all the time you invest in monitoring, I think it's worth. Okay, and the last point I'm going to deal with is the ID management. Okay, well, WebRTC doesn't force any authentication method. The API offers a pretty open framework to be able to use different identity provider. Okay, an identity provider is an organization which certificate that you are who you claim to be. Okay, so depending on the WebRTC deployment, you can use Adhoc solutions. There are many different IDP protocols. You can use OpenID, which is a federated, which allows to federate the identity between different organizations. For example, you can use OpenID in Gmail on Google and also Yahoo, and you only need to, you can use the same credentials to access to different services. You can also use the credentials from your social network. You can, OAuth is a little bit different because it allows to exchange information between two different services without giving the password to all of them, okay? And there is another identity provider, which is Mobile Connect. Okay, this is an the former name of Mobile Connect was Telio, and it was an initiative of Ericsson. The idea is to be able to provide identity services based on the mobile number of the users. Okay, in this case, the telcos will be able to sell identity services to their users by using the mobile number. Okay, I think this is a very interesting opportunity of business. Okay, to be able to get money and to offering identity services. Okay, this is more or less this is a very simplified mechanism. Okay, in this case, we'll see how it works in the next slide, and this is and Mobile Connect. It'll offer a API framework to be able to do something similar to OpenID, but in this case, your identity is your mobile number, and so that the operator can take advantage of the existing assets to offer this service. Well, this is how the identity management has been designed in the peer connection API. Okay, the peer connection is the main element WebRTC, and this API is being defined by the W3C. And this is how it works. Okay, the identity Alice and Bob can have different identity providers. Okay, and when you when Alice wants to make a call to Bob, Alice will contact her identity provider, and the identity provider will generate an assertion which Alice will include in the SDP. This SDP will be sent to Bob, and Bob will contact the identity provider of Alice to check that Alice is who she claims to be, and Bob will do the same that Alice did, contacted a different identity provider. In this case, IDP 1 and IDP 2 have some kind of federation. Okay, but this is the general mechanism which will be used in WebRTC for identity management. Okay, in this case, it's necessary IDP 2 and IDP 1 will have to send JavaScript code to the browsers to be able to do this communication. Okay, and the idea behind that is to leave this very, very open. Well, this is how the identity assertion looks in the SDP. Okay, so if you see in any SDP a line like this, they are using the identity provider, the service of an identity provider to sign the SDP. I think this is still not available in Chrome and Firefox, okay? This is, I don't know when this will be available, but maybe I'm wrong, but I think this is still not available, okay? So, and this is a last example of, this is another identity management scheme. In this case, we are using, this is an application we did 1 year ago, and we use the Spanish identity card portal. In the Spanish identity card, as in many other countries in the world, you have a X 509 certificate, and you can use that to encrypt the connection and also to offer your identity in a trusted way, because we can certificate that you are who you claim to be against the CEA, which deliver the certificate. So this is another example of application which can be developed with using technologies from the web world. Okay, the idea here is, okay, you have a lot of tools to manage the identity in the web world, so you can use it directly to implement applications which used to be in the voice over IP field. Okay, so that's all from my side. I'm going to pass the control to my colleague Victor. Okay, so Victor.
Thank you, Anton.
Okay.
Thanks much. Okay, I hope you guys can now see my screen. Yeah, basically, thanks, Anton, for this magnificent presentation. So what we have been seeing so far is what are the security-related aspects of WebRTC as they are defined in the specifications, and there are people deploying them in the open internet. And now what we will do is, okay, so all this thing called WebRTC, how does it fit with existing deployments in service provider environments, like could be IMS networks? So basically what we will do is we will review the work that the 3GPP has been doing for the last couple of years when it comes to define, okay, how can we now play internet in our telco networks? And then we'll put a couple of examples of some of our customers, how they are deploying this, how they are managing the security, and especially the identities in the new WebRTC IMS domain. So as some of you might already know, the 3GPP has been working on a work item for the last couple of years, which is basically the providing WebRTC access to the IMS. So this is starting from release 12, and now it's being inherited in release 13. So the same concepts with some expansions are now being adopted in release 13. And of course, this has been now included as part of the main IMS specification, which is the 23.228. And basically, as part of the release 12, you can already see a section in the document which is telling not only what this IMS thing is about, but also how to put the WebRTC new framework into the IMS, which is basically yet another access framework for the services which are being implemented into the core network. And then going beyond that, the 3GPP, as they have the different SA groups, once all the architectural work and the protocol-specific work has been done, the 3GPP has been devoting some effort on studying the impact of security mechanisms in terms of authentication, registrations, and so on in WebRTC, and this is basically what I will try to show in the next couple of slides. So just let's take a step back and let's see which is the reference model that the 3GPP is considering for WebRTC. And basically, if you are already used to the typical IMS architecture, you would realize that the signaling entry point into the network being implemented by an SVC, whatever, it's usually called the PCSEF, which is basically taking care of the signaling interface into the access network, and then providing the different functionalities and additional headers, and converting it to the MW a SIP interface into the IMS core. And then if this is for the signaling part, we have the media part, which is basically the RTP flow, which is flying to the IMS access gateway. So now for WebRTC, what the 3GPP has been defining is simply adding some additional functionality in those existing elements. So that's why they decided to put this prefix called E, which means basically enhance. So basically here what we have is the enhanced PCSEF, which is WebRTC compatible, and it means that it can speak any WebRTC related signaling protocol on this side of the picture, and then converting it to the IMS SIP towards the core network. And the same for the access gateway. So basically now it is the extended IMS access gateway, and here what we do is we receive all the SRTP, and as Anton mentioned, the DPLS SRTP, key exchange, fingerprints, etc. And once this is done, we can terminate the encryption and then send it into the core network, into clear RTP, or at best using just SDES-based SRTP. But then, as once the 3GPP realized that, yes, now we have signaling and media compatible with WebRTC, they realized that there is a need for additional functionalities. So in this case, they defined something called the WebRTC web server function, which is, as the name is stating, the a web server. And this web server is one of the functionalities it's doing. It's basically hosting the WebRTC application here. So a user endpoint, which is in this case is just a web browser, can download it and have the application here running, which is the WebRTC IMS client. This is just JavaScript code, which is running into a web browser, can be running in the set-top box, can be an application in a mobile device, etc. But this web server solution is not sufficient to just host the application, but one also needs to perform some kind of authentication or identity management functions, etc. And here is where we have a new logical element, which is called the WAF. And this WAF stands for the WebRTC authorization function, which is supporting on one side into the web server, so you can authenticate and validate people or users before they can actually retrieve the WebRTC application itself. But this WAF element can also support the PCSCF, which means the signaling block, in order to validate signaling requests. So on one side, you can basically validate users before allowing them to download the WebRTC application from your service provider. And then when you have downloaded that and you're receiving signaling, like in terms of registration or trying to make a call, the PCSCF can also go to the authentication or to the authorization function and say, hey, here I have a call which is claiming to be from John Smith. Can you please validate whether this user has the privileges or whether the token is valid? Or just can you translate this Facebook ID to the E164 number which I should be supporting my core network, whatever, okay? So this is basically the reference model that 3GPP is endorsing for WebRTC. And then if we take a look closer to the registration and the authentication, the scenarios and actually what the implementations are doing in the real field mean that since you have from there IMS and SIP, one can simply reuse the existing authentication mechanisms that are in place, which of course they will work, but there are some limitations on that regard, or simply adopt web-oriented authentication mechanisms, which are something new for the WebRTC, for the IMS domain. But since we are now playing into the web league, it's possibly better to start adopting part of these technologies which have been proven into the real applications like Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter, whatever, that they are working pretty well. So if we take a look at the scenarios that 3GPP has been evaluating or actually considering for the specification, this text you can see here is basically an excerpt of the specification itself. I just put in bold letter some of the most important points. But basically, here we have three different scenarios where the first one is where the WebRTC IMS application is simply reusing the authentication mechanisms which are already in place for IMS. So this is somehow assuming that the WebRTC application will be using SIP or WebSockets on the web domain, and basically on one side SIP digest can be used. So basically you're putting into the SIP or WebSockets register or invite your SIP credentials, IMS credentials, like we are doing in other SIP or IMS applications, or we can use the IMS AKI authorization scheme. This is if you want to preserve your existing authentication and authorization mechanisms, but the downside for this, it is that we are now with this putting into the JavaScript code itself some of the credentials that we possibly don't want the users or someone which is in control of the JavaScript or some consoles printing some log messages to discover which are the credentials or to do something malicious with that. And this is why in the 3GPP has been considered the adoption of web-related mechanisms. And these on those web-related mechanisms, they can be, for instance, as Anton has mentioned, OAuth, could be OpenID, there are other flavors. And basically, some of them are basically about putting some opaque tokens into the signaling, so then the party which is validating the token towards the authentication or authorization server can simply validate, okay, so here there is a user which is claiming to be John Smith. Can you please validate what this user is about? And by the way, can you please tell me which is the associated E164 number I need to use for registering this user into the core network? So this is the kind of functionalities we are seeing into the real field. And here, of course, one can, in a dynamic manner, and register the users using something which is called a trust node authentication, which is basically the PCSCF or some other element which is able to register the user on its behalf. Or basically what we can do is pre-provision just a pool of public IMS identities, for instance, and then having these authentication frameworks to be mapped into those IMS identities. So, as we mentioned, one of the options that the 3GPP is considering when it comes to the signaling for WebRTC, it is the CPOR WebSockets specification, which is something we did call for from Qobis in the IDF. And basically, this is about running SIP in web-oriented deployments. But don't take me wrong. I mean, SIP over WebSockets is just one of the different signaling options that one could be adopting for WebRTC. But this is actually the option that the 3GPP has been adopting as example of recommending it into the call flows, into the specifications. But of course, the text is open and allows to other implementers to use JSONs over WebSockets, to use HTTPs over FUBARs, or whatever signaling protocol that might be used here. But having said that, if one decides to go with SIP, like we are seeing in many service providers, and one can also combine OAuth authentication, which is a web-based authentication mechanism, with that. And this is also something we are working on at the IDF, also spending some cycles from Qobis. And basically here we are defining a standard to say, okay, how all these tokens I've been talking about should be included into the SIP signaling itself. So SIP proxies, PCSCFs, SVCs, whatever, which are terminating the WebRTC related signaling, can just go and validate the user or the service it's trying to access. So here we have an example from the specification, which basically, if we just try to remind the architecture we saw here, basically here the elements which are involved on one side, it is the user endpoint, which is basically the web browser or the set-top box, which has some JavaScript capabilities, etc. On the other side, we have here the enhanced PCSCF, which is the one taking care of the signaling for WebRTC. And we saw that there are two new elements. One is a web server and the other is the authorization and authentication server, which basically what we are seeing into the field is that sometimes the implementation is being collapsed into a single, let's say, physical or virtual device. And here the call flow that the 3GPP is defining, it is that the web browser is going to the web server and downloading the WebRTC application, which in turn is being authenticated by the WAF. And then once the application has been downloaded to the browser, what it does is the JavaScript code is simply telling you, okay, which is the signaling server you should be using. And this here is a turn where the WebSocket connection, which is a bidirectional tunnel, as Anton was discussing before, is established towards the PCSCF. And here, the application is sending the register. This could be SIP register. This could be a HTTP POST. This could be a JSON or WebSocket object, whatever. But once the signaling entity is receiving this registration request from the application, what it does is taking the tokens and going again back to the authentication or authorization server and saying, okay, so here I have a register from a user with this token. Can you please validate whether this token is valid, whether this user has privileges to access to this server, whatever. And by the way, in the response include also which are the IMS credentials for that user in terms of public identity, private identity, etc. So the PCSCF can register on behalf of the user with the existing IMS credentials like it is done by from any other device. Well, here we have the similar scenario where basically here we have that the web server functionality and the authorization and authentication, by the way, functionality are not implemented by the same server but in different servers. This is sometimes the case where you are trying to deploy WebRTC in like large enterprises, which they are operating their own web server infrastructure, so the service provider can provide their own authentication platforms, and basically there is here some kind of coordination. So here what we see is again that the WebRTC web server is authenticating the user in terms of web identity before allowing the user to download the application, and once this user can also authenticate itself and get a token, include this token into the signaling, and then once the signaling element into the IMS core network is receiving is receiving the signaling request with the associated token, etc., what this element can do is just go back to the authorization or authentication server and say, hey, tell me whether this user is allowed to do all this, and basically just proceed with the remote authentication towards the core network. That was related to the authentication and the registration. And if we just take a look at the control plane security, which is basically regarding the signaling. As Anton discussed before, the IPF, we decide the architecture for WebRTC, we decide not to mandate a specific signaling schema. So basically, the only thing that the IPF is mandating is just the exchange of SDPs offer answers. So here, some of the considerations that the 3GPP in terms of security is providing in terms of the control plane, it is that the PCSCF, which is receiving the signaling, should support in the SDP the inclusion of TPLS HRTP fingerprints, which in turn they will be used in order to do the key exchange mechanism in a peer-to-peer manner, so we can enable the end-to-end, the peer-to-peer encryption. Also here in the signaling engine, entity should also be supporting things related to ICE, which include start and turn, to basically enable, if desired, depending on the deployment, the establishment of peer-to-peer connections, or simply including some turn server in the path, or simply including a WebRTC gateway in the path itself. And then, of course, what the 3GPP is also recommending, even though that the IPF is not very strict on that, it is that it's using the signaling over an integrity protected channel. So this means that even though that's not mandatory from the IPF specifications themselves, what it's saying is that whatever you are using to send or to exchange the SDP offer answers, just put it over something secure. Then if we go back to the user plane, which means to the media plane, to the how the SRTP is being transmitted, of course here the access gateway should be supporting the functionalities in order to do the NAT traversal, should also support functionalities in order to exchange the keys for DTLS SRTP, and when it goes to the data channels, which is basically nothing else than a connection where you can just put arbitrary data on top of that. So we have voice and video on one side, which is using SRTP with DTLS SRTP, and the other side we have other kind of data, which is application specific. So for instance, for a healthcare scenario, could be like information, biological information that the doctor is capturing from some Bluetooth-based sensor, whatever. So this information is transmitted over DTLS and internal SATP. So here, basically, the media security for RTP, which is basically the voice and the video, what this diagram is showing is that this side of the picture, which is the WebRTC domain of the picture, and then here we have the IMS side of the picture, it means that here we're using the encryption using SRTP with DTLS SRTP, and then once this element is terminating all the SRTP on the core network, it can just send clear RTP. And if you are lucky and the operator is using encryption, for instance using security descriptions, SDES, which is basically the most popular mechanism used for encryption in IMS networks, of course this element needs to decrypt this and to re-encrypt again in order to send it into the network. And here regarding data channel, it's similar procedure. So basically we need to establish a DTLS handshake between the application and the IMS access gateway. On top of this DTLS handshake, we put SCTP. That's something we reviewed in the last webinar about defining WebRTC architecture, but basically this transport has been used for WebRTC data channel. And then once we have this handshake established, we can start sending this arbitrary data, which might be related to healthcare use cases, could be context-based information, or even could use MSRP if you want to do interoping with RCSE devices or doing instant messaging file transfer. You can include DHCP for floor controlling conferences, whatever service you might be running in your core network. This is basically the stack we are using for NAT traversal, which is, again, I mentioned we are using the data over SCTP over DTLS, which is in turn running on top of UDP. And then we have media, which is using SRTP and then running on top of UDP. One of the things we have been learning for the last couple of years, it is that with WebRTC, what we are doing now is just putting voice and video communications and data channel, of course, over some networks which so far were only used for transmitting or sending web traffic, let's call it. And in several networks we of our customers were facing that they are using either restrictive firewalls or HTTP proxies. And this means that those networks are not allowing any traffic to go through the proxy or to the firewall if this traffic is not TCP or something similar to HTTP. So basically what we are seeing and actually doing in real deployments, it is that even though this media and this data is being defined to run over UDP with now some support from the browsers, we can send the media and the data over TCP if it's something that the proxy is required, either using port 80 or port 443. But even beyond that, if the HTTP proxy is kind of looking at the packets and trying to just allow transmission of HTTP-like traffic. One of the things that can be done is simply establish an HTTP connection, like sending an HTTP connect and request, and then send all the real-time traffic as if it was HTTP traffic, like over a TLS encryption tunnel, for instance. And well, you can see some of these mechanisms being described here in this IPF draft. That's something, it's still work in progress, but it's quite interesting to take a look and see which are the different options for that. And then other things that the 3GPP is looking at in the documents is basically, okay, how to do the mapping of the web identity with the IMS identity. So basically, if you want to order a pizza from your favorite pizza shop and you want to use your Facebook identity, if the pizza shop is wanting to call you back just to confirm your address, whatever, you can just map the web identity into the IMS identity for callback purposes or any other service. And then also the 3GPP is explaining documents on how this all thing should be mapped into the WebRTC IMS, which is basically referencing the previous IPF draft I was showing on how to support OAuth with SIP. So basically, this is overall the big picture we have in terms of the specifications. What we have here, the browser with the application, which is just exchanging some SDP objects. So here we have the web server, we have the authentication functionality, we have the signaling function, we have the media function, and then we have the core network. This is what the specs are saying, but at Qobiz, we are likely to be involved in over 100 field trials when it comes to WebRTC and service providers, and we learned that it is good to have this interface so that the PCSCF can validate and can be supported by the WAF functionality in order to validate identities, authorization, etc. But it is also desirable, or something actually a request coming from our customers, to have this authentication function on one side to be accessible or to be able to access to other existing elements. One example we are doing in a customer is just accessing to the HSS, which is basically exposing a REST-based API in order to be able to query the mapping of an IMS and web-related identities. But also we are having some customers which are requesting us to be able to access existing elements, like could be databases, could be Active Directories in Microsoft Link deployments, could be any kind of OSS, BSS, and not only from the authentication functionality, but also from the web server itself in order to provide additional value. So basically, what we are doing from Qobiz is not providing only the WebRTC applications, but also implementing the web server and the authorization authentication functionality in something we call the WebRTC application controller. But of course, we are not simply implementing what the standards are mandating, but we are going way beyond that based on the requirements we are receiving from our customers. One example is this use case we are in a field trial we are running from a service provider in Cala, where basically here we have a WebRTC application which is being supported by the WAC, and then in turn accessing some database into the core network, basically returning the application with the token credentials, and then those token credentials are being verified by the gateway itself towards the WAC. So basically the gateway can just register the user towards the core IMS network. So this is an example in the EMEA region from another service provider, which is a similar example, but in this case, the database we are using into the core network, it is the HSS itself, where basically it is this vendor is exposing a REST API and web services, and basically from the WAC, what we can do is we can query, we can get some information, exchange with the HSS. So basically what we can do is simply extend existing information into the core network towards the new WebRTC domain. And here there is a brand new use case we are running with a customer in APAC, which is basically not using only the operator identity, but also federating identities with external parties. And those external parties can be other operators or can be parties which are sitting in the internet. So basically, if you guys go to any blog and you want to put a comment, typically if you're already logged into Facebook, what you can do is just by using that Facebook login, you can just comment and then your Facebook ID will appear there. So basically what we are doing with this specific customer, I'm planning to do it with a couple of additional customers in the coming weeks, is basically allowing the telephony applications they are providing into the web domain to be integrated in terms of identity with social networks. Of course, as I mentioned, this could be integrated with other APIs, that could be something like an operator providing an API or the Mobile Connect API effort by the GSMA that Anton has been explaining. And basically, here you are allowing your customers to use their Facebook ID or to use their Google ID when they are trying to order a call from Telepizza or any other domain. Well, that's all we wanted to present today. Just in short, just let's say that a legacy voice over IP experience is something fundamental in WebRTC, because we are mostly talking about same set of protocols, and hence some of the tools in place and some of the monitoring elements you might have and some know-how in-house you might have, it's really relevant for that. A difference is that the WebRTC provides security by default, but there are still a number of open things like signaling, identity management, authentication, which are open to the implementation of the specific use case. This means that the service provider needs to take some decisions when defining the service itself, and especially special care should be paid to the authentication and to the identity management, because that's something really critical in terms of how the service will be integrated into the existing infrastructure and what's the kind of service that you want to provide to your end customers. Just to conclude, if you guys are planning to be in Barcelona during the Mobile World Congress, please come and visit our booth. We'll be doing there some demonstrations, not only of our applications, but the WebRTC application controller as well. And if you are lucky enough to be at that the very same week of the Mobile World Congress in Barcelona, we are organizing this free WebRTC meetup, where basically one of the evenings of the Mobile World Congress week, what we will do is we will sit in an auditorium at the university. We will have a number of guest speakers from operators, from vendors, from web startups, from developers, etc. Where basically what we will do is during 5 hours just discuss and share use cases for WebRTC, have some discussions in terms of security, in terms of technology, etc. So if you want to join, the number of spots available are running down quite fast. So I just encourage you to just register today for this event, which is completely free. And this is pretty much what we wanted to discuss today. If there is any question, comment, we'll be really happy to take them.
Okay, do you have any question? Okay. So you can use the chat or the question tool, okay? Well, Victor, I have a question for you. From one of the attendants. Okay, Victor, when do you think we'll start to see the first WebRTC deployments integrated with existing IMS networks?
Well, to be frank, as I mentioned, we are now working with over 100 service providers. So with some of them, we are simply very initial stages, like exploratory phase, running RFIs, try to help them to shape the RFPs and the RFQs in order to help them understand how this could fit into the network and what kind of services they are doing. But having said that, we are working with some other service providers which are moving beyond that, and they are basically post-field trials and lab experimentations. So basically they are in kind of pre-production stage, but they are somehow holding going into production until the technology goes a little more mature, which means that, for instance, a few weeks ago, actually already a month, Microsoft announced that they are planning to support their own flavor in Internet Explorer. There are still a few things to be ironed out in terms of the video codecs, which something unstandardized and agreement was found before Christmas in terms of which is the video codec that should be implemented. But we are likely to see what happens in real implementations during the next few months. So basically, from the discussions I have from my customers, And what I hear is people working in the same space, that's something that, in my opinion, in the second half this year, we will start seeing some IMS-related deployments and services related to WebRTC.
Okay, Victor, thank you very much for your answer. We don't have more questions, so we can finish now. Okay, thank you very much for joining us. You will be able to, if you missed something of the webinar, you will be able to download the slides and also to watch the webinar online in the next days. Okay, so that's all from our side. Thank you very much for joining, and
thank you.
Bye. Okay.